Obsidian is a powerful note-taking application. It has grown really fast over the last couple of years, many people moving from Evernote over to Obsidian. Today, we're going to review Obsidian, see whether it's right for you and whether it's worth it as you choose your note-taking application. We're going to look at the file over app concept, the many features that Obsidian has, and the pricing and free nature of the experience, as well as the pros and cons to see if it's right for you. Hello there, my name is Francesco and welcome to Tool Finder. If you're new here, do subscribe and join Tool Finder. You can go over to toolfinder.co to get insights and reviews on tools and apps for work and life. You'll find the best ones for you, whether it's Obsidian and beyond. You'll find them all there if you're interested. So Obsidian is a really interesting application. And I think one of the first places to start is the free nature of it and the pricing that it comes with. So here's a little bit more about that. So one of the best things about Obsidian is the pricing. A lot of people find that the access to the free experience is one of the killer features because you don't have to pay, you get no need to account or sign up with an email, and you get access to pretty much everything like themes, plugins, and API. And that's great news for people who want to get started. Now, for the individual user, there's actually something called early access. And think of this as a way to get access to beta nice and early, as well as the support forums too. And all you have to do is pay a one-time payment of over $25. It can be more than that if you're feeling generous, but that's how to get early access to stuff with Obsidian. Now, how do they make their money? Because it's important to know, obviously, when it comes to updates and things like that, how are Obsidian generated income? Well, they have a commercial license, which is $50 per user per year for those who want the access when it comes to using it for work. And there's something called Obsidian Sync and Publish. These are priced monthly at $5 and $10 for Publish. And Sync gives you access to syncing across devices. So obviously, if you're using Obsidian on one device, it'll sync only to that device using it local first. But if you access Sync, it will sync across those devices for you and give you end-to-end encryption as well as version history. If you want the publish option, this is great for digital gardens. It allows you to publish your notes to the web and gives you the ability to see graph view and outline as part of that. And that's $10 per user per month, billed monthly. There is option for yearly, which is a little bit cheaper. So that's how Obsidian makes money. And the great thing is that keeps them regularly updating the application. So let's tuck into some of the features and why they're important. Obsidian has something called local first and Markdown. Now, for those who don't know what they are, basically Markdown is a type of file that you can use for your notes. What's beneficial about that? Well, basically, Markdown is supported quite widely. For many people, it's a great way, a great raw way of taking a note. And it means that if Obsidian were to shut down tomorrow, you can move to another note-taking app that supports Markdown. And this is brilliant because many people are in the mindset of this concept of owning their own data and owning their own notes. It also means that if you were to use it for Mac only or Windows only, you get a local first experience, which means that you will be able to store it on your device. You own that device, you own the notes, happy days, which means it is easy to read offline and also to manage on the go. But if you did want to upgrade to the syncing abilities, say you have an iPhone and a Mac, then naturally you'll get the ability to use the sync function, which is $4 per user per month, billed yearly, which will give you access to not just sync between the notes, but also the ability to have end-to-end encryption. So notes and privacy are a key focus of Obsidian. Now inside of Obsidian, you can create a note and it's Markdown. So everything you take in a note is naturally going to be really raw and allow you to do all of the regular stuff you'd expect, like Markdown headers and things like that. Now, the great thing about Obsidian is there's something called bi-directional links, which means you can link or search for anything across your account, creating a relationship between one note and another. This is perfect for those who want to be able to visualize that later on. And I'll show you a few of the ways that that can be done. But primarily people do this because it helps to establish and bring together notes that are across your account, allowing more freeform thinking and ideas to build, creating this network of knowledge and personal wiki in an application. Now, there is a way to visualize this in a better way, and it's called Graph View. Graph View is built into Obsidian. It allows you to even filter things down to orphans, display different options like how the note appears, as well as even just having attachments as part of files. But the concept is very simple. It wants you to visualize the relationships between the notes that you've created, a little bit like how your brain works and the synapses between them. Now, another ability that you get inside of Obsidian is something called community plugins. Now, there is two types of plugins, core plugins and community plugins. This makes it highly customizable for doing really cool things. For example, the core plugins allow you to switch on and off features that you do and don't like. For example, you can even switch on something called an audio recorder, which allows you to record audio notes and save them as attachments. But if you don't want that, you can switch it off. And the same concept goes around. For example, if you really don't like Graph View, switch it off, which is a really nice function that you can do inside of the core plugins. Now, community plugins need to be turned on, but community plugins have a wide range of options. And we're talking a lot of options. There are over 1,800 plugins that the community have created. And if you did want a tutorial on plugins, because this video, whilst being useful, it won't actually cover plugins, I'll link it above if you're interested. But a wide range of plugins means that you can install them and see which one's suitable. For example, there's the ability to create advanced tables that Obsidian doesn't do inside of the app, but it can be used in Markdown, which means you can create Excel-like tables really easily. There's also things like task management, which allows you to turn your Obsidian into a much more focused task management structure. Now, some of these are really hacky, but at the same time, they're a great way to use an experience to its full advantage, even turn it into a Kanban board if you did want to. But there's this great community around Obsidian that will help you to better manage and organize your work. Now, moving on, there's not just a one way to visualize your notes. There's a way called Canvas where you can turn any of your notes into this visual canvas board. And this is perfect for researchers, visual thinkers, and those who want to bring their ideas together. And is a fan favorite for those who use whiteboards every single day. Now, Canvas is a really nice to use because you can add files or existing notes or any attachments to bring everything into one location. So this is perfect for even using as a replacement to things like MillerNote, and you can even connect up cards or notes from your vault and other vaults that you might have. Now, the great thing about the vault concept is you can create a vault and naturally extend it if you did want to, meaning you own the notes. But there is also customizations in themes. If you go to appearances, there is over 160 themes created by the community that you can install and implement right away. Now, it's really nice because that gives you a little bit more play around with how it looks and how it feels. Now, there are some smaller features like daily notes, which allow you to create a daily note every time you have an idea. There's even templates where it sources your templates, and it's great for maybe even having a meeting with yourself or a meeting agenda and using it in place. Now, Obsidian has so much within it. There are so many great things like exporting, replacing, and even split views, reading views, and so much more. There's also a way to scan your backlinks and really break them down with a range of filtering, sorting, tags, and so much more that I probably won't be able to come into this video on. But in terms of the pros and cons, this is why a lot of people like Obsidian. It's highly customizable and it's really tailored towards your need. Obviously, most importantly, the second feature is that it's free. You can optionally upgrade, and it does have a local first approach, which for protecting your data is something that a lot of people are moving towards. The plugin system makes it incredibly flexible, but obviously take note of that because it can sometimes be a little bit hacky in how it looks, but that's up to you and how you customize it. Now, some of the cons of this application is that there's a huge learning curve. I'd recommend checking out Justin DeRose's course on this. I'll link it below if you did want to learn it and go into those advanced note-taking techniques. You can also implement a lot of the systems like Zettelkasten and many more inside of this application. Now, whilst the core experience is free, there are more powerful experiences like sync that are limiting you to sync between devices. For example, if you use two or more devices for your notes, then you're probably going to have to look at sync because that's probably one of the only ways that you can access Obsidian across devices. Both of the mobile applications work very well, although the rich experience is mainly focused on the desktop. So that's something to very much note. So who is Obsidian best for? Pretty much those who are note-taking, want more control of their data, and have a very advanced way of setting that up. If you're not using backlinks, if you're not using graph view, if you're not using a PKM style concept, then I don't know whether Obsidian is right for you. I would say it's probably more suited for those ones who are researching, those ones who are visualizing notes, and those ones who want to be able to save a lot of money and have data privacy as an important thing. And Obsidian can feel quite overwhelming if you're not in that criteria. So I would look at some of the PKM options that we've got if you're not interested in Obsidian but want to explore more. Or you can check out more tools over on Toolfinder in the note-taking space, which I'll link below. Thank you very much, and if you did enjoy this video, please do thumbs it up, because many people will find it as a good resource, and it will work out, the algorithm will put it to more people, basically. So do that, because we'd really love to help more people find out whether Obsidian is right for them. Thank you very much, everyone, and I will talk to you all very soon. Cheerio.